Hello, weirdos, and a happy Wednesday to you, and welcome to another Play Weird stream. My name is Ben, I go by the moniker Ashenhold Art, and this week I'm going to be carrying on with some more little people for my plague crew. So, initially, what I was doing was I would do a group of minions and then like a character model, and I was alternating it like that just to try and make the process of getting everything painted more digestible. But I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and get everything from the Hamlin core box done. So I've at least got something that I can play some small games with and also take some pretty pictures of, if we're being truthful. So I do have Nyx and the Obedient Wretch almost done. I've got all the rats that I'm going to need, but I need to do the stolen, these poor little waifs who are the crew leader Hamlin's totem. So I'm going to be doing a bit of work on them today. I do have, I've got the cards here with me because I quite like using the card art as a reference material. I'm not too sure, I don't want to go too green. I mean, I understand why there's so much green there with it being plague keyword, but I think I do prefer this because I think the creepy eyes sell the plaguey, Hamlin-y vibe enough. And I think we could maybe glaze a little bit of green into them. But I do quite like the pale skin tone. So I think I'm going to go with that. And I think we'll start with this creepy little lady. So if you've been following along, you'll know I've been using Dryad Bark as a tint colour. So the models have had a spray all over of Dryad Bark. And what I'm doing is I'm mixing a little bit of that into most of the colours that I've been using. So just going to carry on with that. So for a paler desaturated skin color, I do quite like using sandalwood. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to mix some sandalwood and some dryad bark together. I'm going to work from that. So little mix there. I'm just using a sheet of plastic card for my palette. Nothing fancy. Okay. A little hair there. I'm just going to paint this on over the skin. Leaving just a little bit of shadow. So if you are working on anything else yourself right now, I would love to hear about that. So feel free to chime in with what you're working on in the chat. Or if you've got any hobby related questions, please feel free to chime in with those as well. And if I can't answer them directly, then I'm reasonably confident that I'll at least be able to direct you to someone that can. So, the brush that I'm using, this is probably one of my preferred brushes of late. This is a Winsor & Newton number one. It's a bit of a Well, it's good to work on your mental health. Something that I think that we probably could all do with working on a little bit more. So, yeah, more power to you with that. I hope that chilling out with us while we're doing a bit of painting is helping with that. Oh, nice. That is a beast of a miniature, that one. I'm looking forward to seeing what people do with that model. I'm also quite excited about the wider implications of the that range. So would that be, are you talking about doing like a grayscale sketch on Playweird, or are you going to do just like a full color sketch? See what you end up with. Playweird will be able to answer that one. I don't think it is, but we'll see what they say. I think vibrant's just the way to go for characters like Sonya, isn't it? With all that fire. So I'm just getting the nice even coat of this down. Something else that I've seen a lot of artists do, which is quite interesting, is rather than oh, hey, Fira. Good to have you. Oh, snow day. Nice. But yeah, with regards to measuring values and volumes in relation to vibrancy and things like that, something that a lot of artists do that I've yet to try myself is, rather than worrying about starting out with like a grayscale primer, a grayscale sketch, you just do your work with your colors, whatever you want them to be. Take some photographs of it with the color set out as you want them, and then what you do is you in Photoshop or another editing software, you gray out the picture, you grayscale the image of the miniature, as you've colored it. And then that gives you a good way of assessing your values and whether they're all lining up correctly. That's quite an interesting thing. I've got a couple of books on that I've been reading. It depends on what you want to do. I actually find a lot of the time painting miniatures is quite cathartic, but if I'm getting frustrated with something that I'm painting, or I just want to relax, I'll make sure that I either change gears from what I have been doing. I'll make a point of doing something that I know that I'll definitely have fun with, rather than trying to challenge or frustrate myself. The thing about that is you can sometimes surprise yourself with what you learn from, I think. You maybe think that you're not pushing yourself, but you know, you're painting something that you've painted loads of times before, and then suddenly you learn something from it. So that's an interesting thing. So I'm going to do a bit of, this is going to be pure sandalwood this time. To make sure that I emphasize the roundness of her cheeks. Definitely want to make her look like she's chewing. It's a really gross little detail that just lends so much character and horror to the model. But at the same time, she's a child, so you make sure I'm keeping that skin nice and smooth. I want to make sure that I'm keeping a bit of shadow in there. I think given the nature of these miniatures, I probably don't want to go. Much warmer with the skin than this. Cragginess there. A little bit winter neck there. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back to a little bit of a mix of Dryad bark and sandalwood again. And I'm gonna blend this a little bit more. Hello there, future maniac. Thanks for popping by. Doing a little bit more work on my Hamlin crew. Thinking if I can get a little bit of extra time here and there that I may be able to at least completely finish the Hamlin core box very soon. Too much water in the paint there. So here's kind of whipping all over her face. Right there. What are you up to this weather, future maniac? Anything exciting? Are you just chilling out today, taking a break from work? Oh, cool. Only dabbled in Gloom. I know that there are people that are fanatical about it. It certainly made a big buzz when it first landed a few years back. I think we're back. Yep, we are back. Sorry about that, guys. Little internet blip there. So, yeah, before I get interrupted, I was saying that I'm going to try introducing a little bit of coolness to some of the skin tones. So, I'm mixing a little bit of Incubi Darkness with some sandalwood. I'm just gonna glaze that in here and there. Just keeping it nice and subtle. Hopefully, it's going to give us a nice bit of variation in the skin. I'm not trying to hit people over the head with these sorts of tones. I'm playing through the breach, my characters faced the free court. Battle went well, with the fated until hands showed up. Damn. So close. So I'm not going to use pale flesh because I don't want to. Put too much warmth into the skin. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to mix a little bit of ice yellow, some Arctic blue. That's going to give me a bit of a green color. And then I'm going to mix some sandalwood in with that. Going to give it a slightly greenish tinge. I can blend some of this in again though. It might look a little bit obvious just now. That's okay. Sandalwood. Got more translucent than that, that's going to be a bit too opaque. Okay, skin tone's looking good. Nice and pale, got enough variation of skin tones in there as well with it, I think. Some cooler elements, some warmer ones. Take just a little bit of dryad bark, sorry, sandalwood. Using lots of very thin, small amounts of paint to alter the colours where I need them to be. Okay. I want to change things too drastically, and then you can't go back. I think that's looking good, so like a little waif, little ghost child. Not too worried about the feet and the legs are looking, because I'm probably gonna dirty them up quite a bit. Okay. Pick out our eyes. So, I think first of all, we'll do a little bit of Incubi Darkness mixed with Dryad Bark into the sockets. So, and bring that down to a wash consistency and just blob that in there. I'm just glazing a little bit of sandalwood back in some of the extremities just to, because she's still alive for all she's quite gone. To the eyes. So I'm gonna start with a bit of Arctic blue. Thank you. could be Malifaux Child Eyes. I'm just going to go back and tidy that up a little bit because there's some parts where I've gone over slightly. So what exactly happened in the culmination of your battle, Future Maniac? I'm guessing it was not good, but I'm still interested to hear. Take this jumper off. Feeling the heat. The Kima arrived along with some of the... Wow, right. The ultimate showdown. Jeez, oh, everyone's turning up. Suddenly the battle turned into a three-way battle. Eventually the Free Corps lost. Ona, one of my characters, got her body parts back from the Autumn Court. Nakima got a piece of crown, the queen. Yeah, totally not about to betray her sister. Okay, sounds fun. Yeah, it's an RPG. I've not yet had the pleasure of trying out, but I would love to. Sounds like lots of fun. Right, so So, the idea with this is just to put a little highlight on the eye in there. There we go. Nice and creepy. And there you have A demonic child. Lovely. I'm just tidying it. High up. Ever so slightly. There we go. I'm really happy with how that skin's looking. Fun time in Malifaux. Exactly, as it should be. Well, let's put some colour in her hair and see how that's looking. So, a little bit of petroleum grey, I think. Won't go amiss. Dryad bark in there as well. And at this stage, I'm just covering the whole lot. Oh, there we go. So there's a little bit of warmth in the hair, as if it's a very dark brown. A nice even nice go with that. Just some darker bits down here, just with straight grey. And here. What we're going to do with her dress. So she's a poor little orphan. It looks as though she's wearing sort of sackcloth. So I think I'm going to go with Kobe Brown. Or do we go warmer? I'll stick with coffee brown, I think. I can put a bit of warmth into it if I want. I love scale 75 paints, but they're terrible for clogging. Use a larger brush for this. And this is just going to be a base coat, so I'm probably just going to go all over with it. Apologise if you can hear barking. My neighbour's Yorkshire Terrier's in the garden and he's got a small man syndrome. Sparks everything. So I've just noticed actually that there's a little bandage on the forearm. I thought that that was where the sleeve was, so I'm going to go back and address that, I think. Because that's a nice little detail that I'd quite like to keep. And then I'm going back in with pure Gobe Brown. I'm just applying that to some of those lighter areas. Tidy that up a bit in just a moment. Okay, so by this stage, we're getting a pretty good idea of how the model's reading, whether we want to pivot on any color choices that possibly made. I'm pretty happy with how it's looking now. Dryer bark. Fantastic little sculpt. All of the plague models are just so characterful. It's one of the things that really drew me to them. That's a bit better, isn't it? Give this a quick blast. Hey, McBluff. Nice to see you, as always. I'm carrying on with plague keyword at the moment. How are you doing today? Just gonna try and, because this dress is stretched tight, so I really want to emphasize that tightness there. So today we are working on the stolen, and this one's gone really well so far, I have to say. I think I might actually finish her on this stream, miraculously, so. Yeah, I don't know if you guys get that. Sometimes you just pick up a model and everything just sort of clicks into place for you. It feels a bit like that with this stolen today. It's nice when it happens. You got a little patch there to paint, and we'll need to do that a different colour. You think about that. So there's actually quite a bit of green in the shadows, in the folds of this robe, in the artwork. I quite like that, so I think I might do a bit of that, and that's something I might go back with some of the other stuff and add in, just to help unify them a bit further. There you go. Thank you. I'm happy with how she's looking. Looking suitably creepy. As she should. Yeah, so I'm going to use a bit of Nocturne Green, which is quite a warm, murky green. But I think we'll mix this nut turn green with a bit of dryad bark again. Make it a bit grosser. Yeah. And then what I'm going to do with that is just let that run into some of those folds like that. And this is going to be our shadow colour, a sort of murky, muted green. And again, this is something that I don't think you're going to need to hit the viewer over the head with this. You can be subtle with it, because you don't want the green to overpower the rest of the model. So we'll probably take some of the green out of this area and just keep it strictly as an accent. I can go back and tidy up a little bit. It's not the end of the world if it strays a bit. So like right in there. Just under the cheeks. I'm looking for deeper recesses, darker areas for that. I'm not just slapping it on anywhere. And it is glaze consistency as well. So it means that it's just slightly altering some of my other colours. It's not masking them. It's working with them to help create those shadows. Okay, I'll go back to my Opie Brown and tidy up a bit. Okay, dry this out. Hopefully you can see how subtle that green is now. So, next. I'm I'm gonna lighten that up a bit. You'll use a bit of star brown for that. Don't want to desaturate fully just yet. So we're reducing coverage, and it's looking for parts where highlights are occurring naturally. I'm not worried if it's a little stark, because I can always just go back and alter that. The good thing is that because she's wearing this sort of sackcloth material, is we can put a little bit of texture in it as well, which is always fun. Oh, I'm way off camera, sorry guys. Sure, yeah, you can ask me. Be glad to answer any questions, yeah. Go ahead. I do quite like muted colours, personally. But I will, it depends what I'm painting, really. Because it's, when conversations about contrast and miniatures come up, they're nearly always about color contrast. So like the color wheel, and it'll be, you know, colors that sit opposite one another on the wheel, warm versus cold, things like that. Saturated versus desaturated is another form of contrast. So there'll be times where you do that and actually have an idea of, I'm going to introduce a wee bit more saturation into this young lady. Hopefully it'll make sense when you see it. It'll be pretty obvious when you see it. It's because using saturated versus desaturated colors and vice versa, it's a technique that you see more often in film and TV than anything. Like if you've seen Breaking Bad, there's the cold open where you see the teddy bear floating in the pool, and he's like a magenta color, like a really saturated magenta, and everything else is black and white. So it means like no matter what you're doing, that's where your attention goes, is right to that. And sometimes miniature painters will use that as well. I can't for the life of me. It's got a proper artistic name. I can't remember what it is. Yeah, it depends what you're doing, doesn't it? I feel like if you're wanting to convey a bit more of the natural world, then you are probably going to tend towards slightly more muted colours, because saturated colours, generally speaking, are synthetic. There's some exceptions to that, obviously. But then it might just be a stylistic choice as well. And that's totally valid. A lot of it is just preference, isn't it? Not really a right or a wrong answer. Questions like that. Okay. I mean, a bit waffly, but I hope that helps. Oh, nearly got a mouthful of water in my lung there. Oh, geez. Yeah, just it really depends on what I'm painting. I feel like the desaturated colors. Are colors that we probably do associate a little bit more with. I suppose when we think of something like plague, it unfortunately is one of these things that go hand in hand with poverty. So generally speaking, you know, your characters like the stolen, the obedient wretch. They are a lot lower in the pecking order, and Malifaux is set during a period in history where, although it is an alternative history, although it is an alternative history and it is a fiction, it still draws heavily upon reality. And the reality is that if you were poorer back during the likes of the 1900s, you probably were not going to have clothes with fancier colours on them. You wouldn't be able to afford the fancier dyes. But now we're able to synthesize a lot of dyes and pigments that previously wouldn't have been available. I'm putting a little bit of texture on with this highlight as well. It's going to help make her clothes look a wee bit more raggedy. A bit more beaten up. And then I'm just going to knock back a little bit of these highlights, just a little. Glaze. It's just going to help blend them in. So we don't want too much visual noise either, so. Just blending some of those colours in. It's going to help to pull everything together a little bit more. They're built in petroleum grey. Okay, I think we'll do some highlights to her hair. I'm using a mix of petroleum grey and anthracite grey. This. Hair's generally quite shiny. Reflects a lot of light, so a lot of movement to it. I still want to the hair to look a little bit like we're in a sort of dingy place, so There we go, nice shimmery wavy here. Might actually darken that down a bit, at least deepen some of the shadows. I'm actually going to use a bit of black to shade it. A bit more contrast is going to help those shinier bits look that much shinier. A little patch, it might be a scratch just on the I'm a big advocate for the rule of cool, personally, when it comes to miniature painting. If it looks cool, who cares what the rules say? It might be that just like things to look a bit more natural, possibly, because, you know, like we discussed earlier, most of the vibrant colours are really man-made or synthetic. Well, it could be that if you draw a lot of animals and things like that, there's nothing wrong with it. Just it's like stylistic choices, isn't it? A few scuffs and scratches on this belt as well. Imagine it's been pretty well worn. I think I'm going to make the rat. I think I'm going to make the rat white, actually. I think that that will be quite striking. So let's do it. This is a very muted palette that I'm using. It's quite interesting looking down at all the colours that I've used so far. Not much warmth at all. Quite cold as well, even the So my plan was that I was going to paint these guys more or less as a batch, but I think I'm going to paint this lady up. I think since Bloody Valentine's coming up, I might do some... might do some quick blood effects on her. Just a child straight up taking a bite out of a rat. fuzzy texture on the poor wee guy. Straight up getting chomped on. Oh, hey, Doug. I managed to catch a little bit of your award ceremony at the Las Vegas Open with your little jester hat on. That looked like good fun. Oh. I know, I'm bursting to go. I might see if I can go next year. What am I doing? So, well, it's a good idea, actually, yeah. It means if even if people don't know you by name, or by appearance. Just tell them to look for the guy in the hat. And then if people lose track of you, you can just look around for the guy in the hat. So yeah, it's a good system. You could, I mean, if you felt so inclined, what you could do is you could get like a braid and stick it to a mask. A big woolly one. You know, if you felt the need to commit to that look. It would also make you stand out even more as well. Whether you think that is a good thing or a bad thing. Yeah, exactly. You could have like a big English Ivan mustache even. Yeah. Could go down that road. The comedy mustaches you could. It's a bit too intense though. Water it down a bit. Yeah, that'll do. Right, so we've got these weird little kind of scaly tails, so I'm just making a point of adding that in there. And we'll do a little bit of a dryad bark shadow. stitch off this bandage here. Just finishing up this bandage. Sharpen up some of the highlights in the hair. Okay, let's think we could do with a bit more of a highlight down here. Maybe. Doesn't look right at the moment. Define these wee streaks of hair a little bit more. It's actually the shadows that need a bit more strengthening. And that's going to help. Those highlights. Okay, so what have we got? I think we'll do some. So I've got this X27 clear red Tamiya. Now this is an acrylic lacquer, it's not a paint. So it does behave a bit differently. And it needs to be thinned with alcohol. But what we're going to do, I'm going to use this to go strong. Add a little bit of grossness. To so we don't want to overdo it though, so the key is less is more. And also we don't want that to look like lipstick. So have it running down corner of our mouth. Get a bit more on and around the rat as well. Okay. smear some of this on her face a little. And the good thing about this, applied sparingly, is that the viewer's not going to be able to help but look at this. So we're not going to dribble it all over the base or anything like that. It's just going to be on the rat and on her face. And get some streaks of it coming down as well. And it's with blood effect, it's very much one of these things of less is more. And of course, you can always paint that on as well. You know, you could just use regular acrylic paint, but if you want a really quick and easy way of doing blood effects, then look no further. Tell me a clear red. She looks really creepy now. So I'm just going to go back in again. Just fill in some of the patches and things. Now, it does mean that the problem that I might have is with the rest of the crew, because of the colours that I've chosen, that she might stand out a bit too much from the rest now. But I can always go in and knock it back a little bit if I want. Add in a little bit more brown, make it look a bit more deoxygenated. But a very gothic-y vibe, like that. So I'm just gonna do a bit of work on our base. Since I've only got half an hour left, I'd quite like to finish something, or at least get something close to finish rather than start something new. Trying to get as much of the brown out as possible. I think there's a bit of field grey in there as well. I think it might be. I don't think it's just. I'll paint those bricks. I'll do a bit of nocturne green for the pool around the base first. Oh dear, it's a bit messy there. Okay. Get those bricks painted. I'm just using some brown grey to paint these cobbles. Make it look like a collapsing walkway in the sewers. It's a blast with a hairdryer. Just under a foot, I think I've missed. It's quite tidy. Rest of those blocks up. Give that a blast and then I'll shade it. Bit of petroleum grey. I'm just using glaze consistency, I guess you would call it. I'm just putting a little shadow and texture into these cobbles. I can actually go a little bit heavier this time. Go and I'll put a little speckling of rainy grey over that. Just a bit of texture to make it look like quarried stone, not just some random brick. Now tinker around with the opacity on that as well. Going a bit heavier. So I'm going to use a bit more water in it.
That'll help to soften their edges a little bit. Make them look a bit rougher, a bit more worn in. You can actually, a good wee trick to use if you want to make it look a bit more worn is see if you curve your highlight along those corners. It's usually a big no-no, but it works quite well when you're doing a bit of weathering. Oh, I'm way off camera. Okay, I don't have a lot of time left, so I'm not going to do all the bricks just now, but what I'm going to quickly do is paint the rim of the base just to... And then all I've got left to do is the UV resin for the water and a little bit of... I'll probably do a little bit of the gunky moss that I've put onto the rest of the miniatures I've finished so far. Okay, let's give this a quick blast. There you go. One almost finished stolen. Yay. Looking very Malifaux there. Creepy little goth kid. Biting into a rat. All right, guys. Well, that's it for me this week. Please swing by tomorrow where Jess and Eleanor will be streaming on our double feature. I'm going to try and finish some more of these models that I've started so that hopefully we can start something new, but there you go, times. Eleanor at 11, Haunted at 3. Might use next week to finish up some of the stuff before we move on to Hamlin. I'll have a think about that. But yeah, make sure you pop by and see what they're doing. Yeah, that is it for me this week. I will be back with more Plaguey shenanigans. Thank you very much for joining me. And hope the rest of the week's not too strenuous for you. Cheers, guys. Thank you.